Grieving While Black, An Anti-Racist Take on Oppression and Sorrow by Breeshia Wade, narrated by Michele Lyman, published by North Atlantic Books. Dedication. To Mary, my twin flame, I've spent a lifetime chasing dreams, but you are a reality that exceeds even my wildest imaginings. It's been a difficult journey, but thank God for love, for grief, for you. Preface. When I was in undergrad, I initially majored in cultural anthropology because it allowed me to study culture, communities, and aspects of human nature. But anthropology is a social science, and I found that trying to examine human nature through a scientific lens was a painful process. Human experience can be neither replicated nor recorded with accuracy. We can observe communities, but life cannot be quantified and is not predictable. As a burgeoning anthropologist, I began to look at myself as a scientific instrument through which the experience of others would be conveyed. However, unlike an Erlenmeyer flask, I could not be sterilized before each experiment. My own life experiences would always contaminate the way I perceive the experience of others. My approach to this project is informed by who I am. I can neither feign objectivity nor distance myself from what I have inherited and who I am called to be. I am a Southern Baptist-raised Black woman and practicing Buddhist from Chester, South Carolina. I have written on a topic very close to my heart, a topic that has permeated my experience as a human being and as a Black woman observing the unspeakable tragedies committed by and against a people. Tragedies kept alive by silences, haunting generations, memories recorded in bodies restless and weary, all waiting to be spoken. When I heard these ghosts knocking in the closets of my unconscious, I was afraid to answer for fear of the questions they might bring. What unwanted light in my mind would be shed on a community that is already so laden with brokenness and shame? Who was I to disturb the voices of generations buried for the sake of my survival? And who was I to build on top of these voices a life where the past no longer threatened to undo the present? But I chose my life over fear. When I opened the door and listened, I learned that these ghosts were not our enemies, but our friends. And although many of them bore truths that cracked the rocky foundation of my own identity and perception, they offered hope. We are here to heal. We can ignore the knocking of these ghosts of grief so that we don't have to look them in the face, but we can't avoid the impact of the haunt or what our fear and sadness causes us to inflict upon the people around us. We have a moral obligation to attend to our own grief and to interact responsibly with the grief of others. My intention in writing this book is not to provide coping mechanisms or short-term fixes for the grief we experience throughout our lives. This book is meant to elucidate grief in all of its forms and to provide a map back to ourselves that allows us to encounter our wholeness without fear while showing up to do the long-term work that needs to be done. Introduction. Now I'm bound for Mount Zion, way out on the hill. Said I'm bound for Mount Zion, way out on the hill. And if anybody makes it, surely I will. South Carolina, Black Baptist Hymn. Often when people imagine what it means for Black lives to matter, they focus on the explicit death of Black people, like those caused by police violence. Almost every system of injustice within the United States is either founded upon or informed by anti-Blackness, including racism and white supremacy. Consequently, there are a myriad of ways that anti-Blackness ensures that Black folks are not meant to live, let alone thrive. Many of my readers likely participate in the destruction of Black lives despite their political and social leanings, unwittingly and against their best intentions. At its core, anti-Blackness relies upon neither our consent or our awareness to extract participation. White supremacy attempts to pervert Black life into a living death through the destruction of possibility, where individual flaws that would naturally be a fleeting moment, a failing, becomes failure, an all-encompassing state of being. I am intentional about not attaching the term failure to a specific action or endeavor, because our relationship with failure, as opposed to failing, already evokes a visceral reaction. Our minds and bodies experience failure as an absolute without it being attached to anything specific, which is why depression feels so abysmal and we spend so much of our lives avoiding the feeling of failure or being labeled a failure at anything. Black people don't just face death at the barrel of a policeman's gun or within our medical system. Life is taken from us on a daily basis through housing discrimination, through the inability to get or maintain a job that allows us to pay rent, have health insurance, and buy food, and through undercompensation. After spending years working in environments that were toxic at best, I found a company where I felt I could thrive. I joined this company in the middle of a pandemic that was wreaking disproportionate havoc on Black communities, right before the eruption of worldwide protests defending Black lives. This company wasn't actively hiring when I applied for the role, but I applied anyway, despite the fact that many businesses were laying people off. I got the job. I knew that I'd be good at this role, and it felt nice to experience mutual recognition between myself and a company. Despite my aptitude, hard work, and conviction, I found myself struggling significantly. After 5 weeks, I began reassessing what was wrong. I was in a customer-facing role in a business-to-business, B2B, company, and I was constantly encountering aggression, dismissal, and disrespect the moment I introduced myself over the phone as Breeshia. After a few attempts to stumble over my name, decision makers would typically decide that the conversation was not worth having and would rudely end it. Being Black in America means that I'm always questioning whether or not a situation would have happened differently if I were white. The grief isn't so much in whether or not the answer is unequivocally yes, but in the fact that so many life experiences cause me to consider this question. And the extra mental energy this consideration saps throughout the day. In any case, I imagine that I was particularly sensitive to instances of outright aggression toward me, which was heightened when I spoke my name. Tonal shifts after my introduction, demands that I never call again, accusatory questions, I was witnessing the violence and dismissal of Black women's lives daily, e.g. Breonna Taylor, Ayanna Dior, J. Cole's Foolish Song. And then I was calling white people and hoping not to be dismissed. To be sure, some of this type of behavior simply comes with my role, but the degree to which my endeavors were marked by failure seemed to differ from some of my colleagues, and it was threatening to deteriorate my life outside of work. As thoughtful as my company was, I knew that businesses are driven by metrics and that they couldn't carry me as dead weight forever. If society would not accept Breeshia in a professional role, then my job, and thus my ability to survive, was under threat. Other people's failure to recognize and respond to me as a human being with something to offer meant that their vision of me had the capacity to influence my personal life by ensuring that I struggled to afford rent, to afford marriage, to plan and provide for a family. So I flattened myself into who white business owners needed me to be. I became Bree, and I removed pictures of Breeshia with her locks and Black features from my email and profiles. Sometimes I gave my voice a lilt, adjusted my vowels, made myself as telephonically white-passing as I could. Other times I would close my eyes and conjure the image of a Black person that would feel more familiar. Bree lives in a high-rise, I whispered to myself. Bree brunches with her white girlfriends. She played lacrosse in college. I could be Black, maybe, but there was a certain type of Black that they needed to imagine me to be in order to form even the most casual of bonds. Bree could just as easily be their daughter's best friend or the daughter of a good Black friend, but Breeshia could never be any of those things. It didn't matter how well-spoken, well-educated, thoughtful, or resourceful I was. It didn't matter that I could articulate their problems and bring them solutions. Breeshia was not fit to be given an opportunity to prove herself, to exist, and therefore, implicitly, to make a living in order to survive. Within 2 days, Bree had accomplished what Breeshia couldn't do in 5 weeks. She booked multiple sizable accounts. Bree went weeks without experiencing the slightest bit of aggression, even from people who had previously been hostile. Those same people became open to continued conversation and began connecting her to their business partners and colleagues. Bree was entrusted with the cell phone numbers of CEOs without suspicion or hesitation. All of this was happening as companies were beginning to respond to the social pressure to declare their stance on Black lives. Every day, my inbox was flooded with emails from one CEO and founder or another declaring their solidarity with the Black community. And every day, my stomach turned as I read their empty statements. Knowing that these very people were priding themselves on their comfort doing business with Bree. I have frequently experienced violence as a result of my gender and my skin color. From the white woman who refuses to put money directly in my hand when I make a purchase at the store, to the Black men who feel entitled to sexually harass me because I'm the only Black woman available in a sea of white. I love my full name, Breeshia Latte Wade. And I feel proud of who I am. My colleagues and friends call me Breeshia. Unfortunately, I am not the only Black person who has had to contort myself in order to survive. What white supremacy cannot accomplish physically through death and assault, it seeks to accomplish spiritually. Systemic racism was meant to destroy Black people's relationship to ourselves, to each other, and most importantly, for its own survival, to white people. The very fabric of our country was premised upon Black people's expendability. We were brought here to die. White people were never meant to be in a meaningful relationship to us because they were never meant to see us as people. Superficial proximity was necessary, but genuine connection was not in the source code. I know this in the moments of both greatest joy and greatest pain in my relationship. There are moments in which my wife and I look into each other's eyes from both inches and miles apart, separated by a short and endless gulf that neither of us can do anything about, that white supremacy did to us, and these moments feel insurmountable. We were never meant to be what we are to each other. Everything in our society was built to guarantee it, and it makes sure to remind us in little jarring moments of empathetic failure and huge earthquakes of mistrust. I've lost count of the moments I feared that my wife's courage would not suffice because we both know that in this system, no action will ever be enough. But we keep showing up anyway, knowing that success is fleeting at best, and failure always lingers on the horizon. This moment has galvanized white people for reasons I still don't comprehend, though I welcome what hope it brings. But white people who are invested in racial justice must come to terms with their relationship to grief. If one looks at the root of anti-Blackness, what it has done and what it aims to do, how does one not feel burdened by the tears of generations? How does one not touch the very heart of grief? And if one has had such an honest, unveiled encounter with loss, how can one fundamentally remain unchanged? I've witnessed many white allies and activists who quickly became overwhelmed, bogged down, discouraged, and exhausted. They are experiencing a fragment of disempowerment in a system that caters to them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.